Welcome to the show. We're so glad that you tuned in. Today we have a wonderful show for you. We are a Believers variety talk show in Santa Cruz, California. And just get some popcorn, sit down, and enjoy the show. Have a good time.
Deliverance and restoration and reformation to Psalm 126. And while I was there, he just highlighted some things and said, this is a psalm I want you to get into. This is for us now. And when I say us, I meant for me, for you, for this region, I believe for the body of Christ. And so I started praying into that, and Pam, who is one of my sweet friends, I texted her. I said, this is the word the Lord gave me, Psalm 126. And she texted back and she said, no way, because I just wrote a few weeks ago a psalm about Psalm 126. And so the same spirit speaks to both of us.
Yeah. Yes.
And so that made us wonder, because God is a God of wonder. He yes. is wonderful, counselor, right? Yeah, and so as I began to seek the Lord on that and went in deeper on it, we sensed that God wanted to release something over our bodies, so we decided, with the prompting of the Lord, that we would come into this together. I think this is going to be a template that the body of Christ is being knit together, that the solo teams are probably a thing of the past. This isn't a one-person show, but that the body of Christ is to click together.
Come on.
Pam and I are bringing our portion tonight, and what our goal is we're hoping that you'll receive some deliverance, freedom, restoration, and reformation. So, what I'd like to do is, would you mind just opening us up in prayer?
Dear Lord, we just thank you for your awesome presence here tonight. Lord, I just ask that we would have ears to hear what it is that you're saying. And Lord, I ask that you would speak to each person right where they are at, and that they would hear exactly what it is that you want them to hear. It's not about us, it's all about you, Lord Jesus. And we just give this night every word that is spoken, we give it all to you, Lord God, in Jesus' name.
All right, we're going to go ahead and start out, and we're just going to start out by reading Psalm 126 in the Passion Version, and we have it up here on PowerPoint. And so this is, tonight's message is a message that we believe that there is an action response that God is calling each of us, including ourselves. So let your spirits be open, because there will be something we believe that God is wanting you to step into.
It was like a dream come true when you freed us from the bondage and brought us back to Zion. We laughed and overflowed with gladness. We were left shouting for joy and singing your praise. All the nations saw it and joined in, saying, "The Lord has done great miracles for them. Yes, he did mighty miracles, and we are overjoyed. Now, Lord, do it again. Restore to us our former glory. May streams of your refreshing flow over us until our dry hearts are drenched again. Those who sow in tears as seeds will reap a harvest of joyful shouts and glee, and they may weep as they go out, carrying their seed to sow, but they will return with joyful laughter and shouting with gladness as they bring back armloads of blessings and a harvest overflowing."
Yes.
Yeah. Woo. So, again, the goal tonight is deliverance, it's freedom, it's restoration, and it's reformation. So the reforming. And I'm going to do a quick whirlwind through a little bit of where did this psalm come from? What was the origination of it? And what is this psalm about? And see how it ties into us today. And then we're going to get a testimony from Pam, because I believe she is a prophetic example. Her life is a prophetic example of invitation for "Do it again, Lord." And so by responding to this prophetic example of what she is through this psalm, tonight we're going to give an invitation for God to do some deliverance for us. And so that's the plan. So a little bit about the history of the psalm. Psalm 126, it's a psalm that is reflective of the children of Israel coming back. So this is going to be a little bit of a whirlwind, but it's really significant because God is doing the exact same thing right now, I believe, in history and in this region. So the children of Israel were coming back from a Babylonian captivity. And it's shown through the brilliance and the extravagance of God's plan as we just see how was it that he laid this thing out. And if you look at the last chapter of 2 Chronicles, which is 2 Chronicles 36, you're going to see just prior to this psalm being written, a declaration of what was going on. And the children of Israel had had mainly bad kings for a long time. And each time the history says, and that king did what was evil in the sight of God. And at that time, 2 Chronicles is one of the historic chapters. It explains, this book explains what was on God's mind during this time. And I just wrote portions of the scripture that are key for tonight. 2 Chronicles 36, in it says, "The Lord, the God of their fathers, sent word to them again and again by his messengers, because he had compassion on his people and on his dwelling place. But they continually mocked the messengers of God. They despised his words and scoffed at his prophets, until," it says in the New American Standard, "there was no remedy." So you just see the goodness of God asking people to turn and to repent and to follow him like a good, good father. And so basically what happened as a result was Israel was sent into exile. Babylon was totally destroyed. Jerusalem was totally destroyed. The city was burned. The walls were torn down, and the temple was physically burned. So it was down to rubble, and there was nothing left. Most of the people were killed. It says in the end of 2 Chronicles, young and old alike, they had no mercy on. Men and women alike, they had no mercy on. And so the women and children were killed, and those who escaped, it says, that's in quotes, the sword, he carried off away to Babylon. He carried away to Babylon. And it doesn't really say if that he is the king or that he is God. So if you go to the next slide. So here we see that that the people are taken into captivity. At this time, there is a prophet named Jeremiah, and he's called the crying prophet. He wrote the book of Jeremiah and the book of Lamentations. And before they were carried off, he was the primary voice of his day that said, look, you guys, the Lord is calling you back. Turn. And so they didn't listen to him. They actually put him in a pit, and they ignored him. So after the city was burned, he was really considered of such low significance that they left him there. They, being the Babylonians, left him there. And so the Lord came again and gave Jeremiah a vision. And in this vision, he showed him a few things. And so Jeremiah wrote them up and sent them as a letter to the Babylonians who had gone into captivity. It says, Jeremiah, this is right out of 29. Jeremiah sent a letter to the exiles in Babylon. Build houses, live in them, plant gardens, take wives, have children, multiply. Seek the welfare of the city where I have sent you into exile. Pray to the Lord on its behalf. For its welfare, in its welfare, you will have welfare. And then later he says, when 70 years... 70 have been completed for Babylon, I will visit you and fulfill my good word to you to bring you back to this place, meaning Jerusalem. For I know the plans. That's where we know this verse. And this is where it comes from. Mm-hmm. Jeremiah saying it to the people through God, for on God's behalf, who are in captivity. For I know the plans that I have for you, plans for welfare and not for calamity, to give you a future and a hope. And so this letter goes out, and it's sent into Babylon. Meanwhile, one of the young men who was there in Babylon, Daniel, he was taken off as a young man, gets favor with the king. He with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they become counselors. And in the book of Daniel, so this is God's just extravagant, intricate plan. In the book of Daniel, it talks about Daniel and his service to the kings of the Medes, the Persians, the Babylonians. He saw quite a few kings. And in Daniel 9, it brings up that Daniel, it says, in the first year, this is Daniel speaking first person, of his, Darius's reign, I, Daniel, observed in the books the number of years, which was revealed as the word of the Lord Jeremiah the prophet, for the completion of the desolation of Jerusalem, namely 70 years. So here was Daniel, and he had found this letter of Jeremiah's. Who knows where it was, but he had access to the king's stuff and to the leader's material. So he was reading, and whoa, he saw the number 70, and he realized, wait a minute. That's time. The 70 years is time, because he was there as a young man. He was brought to Babylon. So he saw it was 70 years. So I gave my attention, this is his response, to the Lord to seek him by prayer and supplication with fasting, sackcloth, and ashes. And this is what he prayed as part of it. It's a beautiful prayer in Daniel 9. Read the entire thing. But I want you to hear what he says. He says, O Lord, hear. O Lord, forgive. O Lord, listen. Take action. While I was still speaking, and so Daniel's explaining what happened while he's praying. While I was still speaking in prayer, it should say, the man Gabriel, and we know he was not the man at all. He was actually an archangel, the archangel Gabriel. The man Gabriel, whom I had seen in a vision previously, came to me and gave me instruction, talked with me at the beginning, and said, at the beginning of your supplication. So what happens at the beginning of our prayer? Something in the spirit is activated.
Absolutely.
Angelic regions are activated. So forces, our words are activating things in the spirit. He says, at the beginning of your supplication, the command was issued. So that is just showing that Daniel's prayer and all of this was working together in the timeline of God's brilliant history. So as a result of it, we go to the very last chapter, again back to 2 Chronicles, and it talks about, now in the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia, in order to fulfill the word of the Lord by the mouth of Jeremiah, the Lord, this is what happened in the angelic, the Lord stirred up the spirit. I wonder how that happened. Messenger Gabriel, of Cyrus, king of Persia, whoever there is among you, he said, of all his people, may the Lord his God be with him and let him go up. And so now we see this release of captivity through prayer, through angelic, through declaration. And so now we go back to Ezra. Because this psalm, we're starting and coming full circle, Psalm 126, is called the Song of Restoration. The Psalm or the Song of Restoration. It was actually sung. And Ezra, who is one of the priests that came back with the early remnant in order to respond to Cyrus's decree, said, and he wrote a book called Ezra, whoever there is among you, he explained why he was there back in Jerusalem because of what Cyrus said, of all his people, may his God be with him. Let him go up to Jerusalem and rebuild the house of the Lord, the God of Israel. Everyone whose spirit God has stirred up to go arose to build the house of the Lord. So once again, angelic activity it was precipitated by prayer and by the spoken word, the declarative word, by Cyrus's decree, as he heard and agreed with the word of the Lord. So it was at this time, Ezra goes back and he takes with him, there are about 14,000 people. The list is in the first and second chapter. And what we see as a result is the remnant returned, the rebuilding of the altar, because the entire place was in ruins. The temple was in ruins. It had been burned out. And so they started and they cleared the rubble. That was the first thing they did in Ezra 1 and 2. And then they built an altar. That was the first thing. There's no building there. It was just unhewn rocks of an altar. Now all who came from captivity to Jerusalem, and here's the key to what God's calling us, began the work to oversee the work of the house of the Lord. And so we see that the people who came began, they got a vision. God showed them some things that he was stirring in them, and they began the work. And they started with the altar. And then it says they settled, they got in. Some of them lived in Jerusalem, some of them went to the land. And in the third chapter, it talks about when the song happened. Now the builders had laid the foundation. So after the altar came, just this foundation, no building, no walls, no roof, nothing else, no porticos. It's just the foundation, like a bare slab of some sort. The builders had laid the foundation of the temple of the Lord. The priests stood in their apparel. They'd been gone. No worship to the Lord had been done for 70 years. And the Levites and the sons of Asaph, symbols to praise the Lord according to the directions of King David of Israel. They sang praising and giving thanks to the Lord. And all the people shouted with a great shout when they praised the Lord because the foundation of the Lord was laid. The people shouted with a loud shout and the sound was heard from far away. And what they shouted was Psalm 126. And it's a talk about the return from captivity, the joy that was released, the hope of restoration. And it is a word, a prophetic word for this time. It is a promise that God is releasing, that he wants to manifest in joy
in freedom, where we are captive, where we are captive, he wants to release us. And so I want to hand it over to Pam, because her life and her testimony and her most recent journey with God is a manifestation not only of this psalm, but what God wants to do for all of us. So I believe your life is a prophetic statement.
How many of you have been waiting for breakthrough? Something in your life, you need breakthrough. I had major breakthrough happen, something that I've been waiting for a long time, that I've been working toward. But let me go back and give you some background on my journey and how I got to this place. I'm going to start with my mom. My mom was raised in a Christian home. She grew up. She met my dad, who was a beer-drinking, smoking, swearing man. And for some reason, she decided to marry him. And to the horror of her parents. And so they got married, and they had a daughter, Roxanne, and a son, Pat. And Roxanne was born with what they called then a bad heart, but what we know now is a heart murmur. And I guess it was pretty severe. And when she was 8 and a half, she got rheumatic fever and she died. And so my dad just was not handling this very well. And the doctors told my mom to hurry up and try and get pregnant, and hopefully they would have another girl and it would save my dad's life, basically. And so my mom got pregnant, and here I am. So when I was 3, my dad got saved. He gave his life to the Lord, and he gave up all that stuff. And my whole life growing up, as young, I was in church all the time. We were in church Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, and then there was revivals all the time, so you were in church every night. So we always had something going on at church, and it was a big part of our lives. And my daddy was my everything. So if he was around, I was attached to him. If we were watching TV, I was on his lap. If we were walking, I was holding his hand. If we were sitting in church, I had my arm linked in his. I just wouldn't let him out of my sight. And then when I was about 10 years old, my dad became a pastor. And they gave him a church over in the Modesto area, and we moved there. And before too long, my dad had an affair with his secretary, who was 20 years younger than him. And that was the end of our family. So my life as I knew it drastically changed. Everything was different. So my parents got a divorce, and he married this woman, and they had a son. And when he was about a year old, they moved from a place that they were at and canceled their phone number with no forwarding number. And I would sit at the phone and dial the number over and over and over and hope that they would reinstate their number. And I couldn't find him. He didn't call me. I didn't hear from him for a year. And one of the things that happened during that time for me that was so scary was I would go to bed at night. And I was probably about 11 or 12 at this time. I would go to bed at night, and when I would close my eyes, I felt like I was being pulled into a deep, dark, black pit. And there was nothing but blackness. And I felt like I was going to this nothingness, there was never going to be anything but this blackness. And I would have to, you know, open my eyes and shake my head and tell myself, think about something else. Because it would just pull me into this horrible place. And I finally made a collect call to his mother-in-law, because my mom would have freaked out if I made a call and it cost money. So I made a call, and she accepted the call, and I said, "Where's my daddy?" And she said, "Honey, I'm so sorry." She said, "I tell him to call you all the time. I'll tell him again." And so he finally got a hold of me, but you know, our relationship was never the same again. I didn't have that closeness with him because now he had this other family. He had this other wife and this other child. And my mom, she married a guy who thought it was his mission to ground me and spank me. And so being who I am, I didn't like that. My dad never hit me, ever. And having this man who, like, who are you? Who are you? And I would run from him. I would fight back. And eventually I ran away from home. And after that, I moved in with my dad and his wife and his son. And when I was about 16, I decided I stopped going to church. My dad said, "It's up to you. Do whatever you want." And so I quit going to church because for me, I had being a child of divorce and how it felt was I was looked down on. People don't tend to give the kids the grace that they need when they're going through this. You know, people will say, "Oh, how are the kids doing?" "Oh, they're doing just fine. Kids are resilient." No, they're not. No, they're not. They will, at some point, manifest something from this if it's not dealt with, if you don't talk to them about it. And, you know, it's just like, get on with your life. Your life has changed. Now you have, you know, and it felt like, to me, it felt like I didn't belong anywhere because my mom's house was her house and her husband's house, and my dad's house belonged to him and his wife. So where did I belong? I didn't feel like I belonged. So when I was 16, I stopped going to church, and because I didn't want to be around those people. The people I knew who weren't Christians were way nicer than the Christian people that I knew. So I stopped going to church, and I started partying. I started drinking and smoking and doing drugs, and I was having a great time. It was a whole lot of fun, and I didn't have to deal with these judgmental Christians anymore in my life. When I was about 19, I met this really good-looking guy. Whose name is Greg. My awesome sound man. And we started dating, and we moved in together, and we were together for 4 years, and we decided to get married, and we had a couple of kids, and he had his roofing contractor, and I became a stay-at-home mom. And if you've ever been a stay-at-home mom, this is the hardest job you'll ever love. But anyway, I started raising our kids, and I started going to jazzercise, and I would jazzercise 7 days a week, but I would still drink and smoke and do drugs. And eventually I started going, this makes no sense. What am I doing? Why am I doing this? So I gave up the partying. And when I did, I found that I was in a lot of pain. So I needed to do some things in my life differently. You know, when you give up things like that, you have to change your life. You have to do different things so that you don't go back into that pattern again. So I decided to go to Cabrillo College and take some classes. And one of the classes I took was psychology. And that started changing things for me. I just felt the pain in my heart so bad. And my husband would sit with me and hold me while I told him things that had happened to me and cried. And I would just sob like a baby. And he was so gracious to, you know, not look at me. So when I did the ugly cry, I didn't, you know, he didn't see me. But he just instinctively knew how to help me through that and talk with me. And that began my journey to wholeness. So I always knew that I wanted my kids to go to church and learn about God. I just didn't want to have to go with them. And so when our daughter was in the sixth grade, she wanted some new friends. And so I said, okay, we'll go to Twin Lakes. I always knew I'd take them there. So as we went to a Wednesday night junior high Wildside event, and on the way there, she said, I don't want to go. I don't want to go. Let's go home. I said, no, we're going to go, and if you don't like it, we'll go home. So you get there and we're watching all this. It was called Wildside for a reason. And we're watching all this craziness going on, and these little girls came up and said, want to play? And so she took off, and that night we went into another room, and the youth pastor gave a message. My daughter was right up in the front with these little girls, and I'm sitting in the back. And his message was on friendship. And I'm sitting in the back, just tears flowing down my face. And so I decided on Sunday that I would take both of my kids to church. And as I was walking the halls upstairs at Twin Lakes Church, the worship started. Now, you have to realize that when I quit going to church, there was barely even a guitar. It was piano, organ, hymns. That was it. We were just starting to get a little bit of contemporary music. So I'm walking the halls, and it's a full band playing, and I'm like, wow, you know, what is this? And the tears just start flowing down my face, and I felt like God said, you're home. This is home. So I still was very leery about church and about Christians, and but I started going to things, and every time there was something going on, I would go. And how many go to Twin Lakes and know that there's always something going on? So I started reading Christian books, and one of the things that I didn't remember ever really learning about growing up was Holy Spirit. So I started getting books on Holy Spirit, and who is the Holy Spirit, and what is this? And so I ended up joining the choir, which I called up the worship pastor, and I said, so I'd really like to be in your Christmas production, but I don't want to sing in your choir. And he said, well, you know, if you're going to be in our Christmas production, I need you to commit, at least during that time, to sing on Sunday in the choir. If I have to. If I must, I must. So I ended up doing that, and pretty soon I became part of the worship team, and I joined the women's Bible study, and the Bible study leader saw something in me, and she pulled me right into the leadership. And I wasn't ready for leadership at all, so she had me sell tapes, but she didn't want me to fall through the cracks. She wanted to make sure that I kept coming. So we had our Bible study on Tuesday mornings, and on Wednesday mornings, every Wednesday morning for I don't know how long, I would call her in tears and say, I'm quitting. I can't do this. I will never measure up to who God wants me to be, and I can't do this. I'm quitting. And every week she would say, you're okay. You're going to be fine. Come as you are. You're fine. Just come. It's going to be okay. So I kept going. And, you know, my mom, she passed on to me a critical and judgmental spirit. And me being the personality that I am, I took it and ran with it. So it was like judgment on steroids. So I continued to grow in the Lord and continued to learn. And he had me like on a fast track. Like it was constantly learning, growing. But I carried so much unforgiveness, so much bitterness, and extreme judgment. I could judge anybody in a heartbeat. I know who you are, what you've done, and I can see it, and no problem. So I worked really hard to change, but eventually I got sick. Because how many of you know that when you have dis-ease in your body, it can bring disease?
Absolutely.
So in 2005, I was diagnosed with an autoimmune disease called sarcoidosis. And it had first showed up in 1992, but nobody knew what it was at that time. So eventually I gave up all my commitments, so I couldn't do much of anything but lay on the couch and feel awful. You know, I would get up from the couch and try to go to the kitchen to get something to eat, and I would just fall on the floor sobbing. And during this time, we had stopped going to our church. Our daughter was in a horrible, violent marriage. Our 15-year-old dog was dying. My mother-in-law was dying of Alzheimer's. And my husband was working out of town all week. My cousin sent an email one day and she said, "I'm drowning in my sorrow." And I went, "That's it. That's what I'm doing. That's where I'm at. I'm drowning in my sorrow." So I spent a lot of time, I just dug into God's word, and like, I know what God's word says. I'm not going to accept this. I know what his word says, and I want all that his word says. I go to the doctor, and they wanted me to take steroids, immune suppressors, and things, and I wouldn't do it. You know, I'm not saying don't go to the doctor, don't take medications, because I do. But with this thing, there is no known cause, and there is no known cure. Well, I know who causes it, and I know who the cure is. My healing with all I had, whenever I had it, and I got in healing prayer lines, I spoke out God's word, tried to control my mouth, but that was really hard. It was judgment. It was just something that I couldn't get a grip on. I could never get a grip on this, and it was really difficult. You know, I spent quite a few years really trying to get a grip on it, and I couldn't. I changed my diet, we changed everything in our home, got rid of all the chemicals, whatever it took to be healed. So I spent the last 13 years going after my healing with lots of ups and downs in my health, but I always had a mouth problem that I was trying to change. I've always been very, very sincere about seeking the Lord. And my first favorite verse when I came back to the Lord was Jeremiah 29:13. "You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all of your heart." And then I loved the first line of the next verse that says, "I will be found by you." But I didn't think the rest of it pertained to me until this happened. And I looked at it the other day and it says, verse 14 says, "And I will bring you back from your captivity. I will gather you from all the nations and from all the places where I've driven you, says the Lord. I will bring you to the place from which I caused you to be carried away captive." You know, sometimes we forget that there's cause and effect. I wasn't getting the effects I wanted because of what I was causing by the words of my mouth. I didn't have very many friends because, really, who wants to be around that? Proverbs 26:2 says, "Like a sparrow in its flitting, like a swallow in its flying, so a curse without a cause does not alight." So in the beginning of December, I bought this book called The Healing Journey. And one of the things that the author tells you to do is to pick a scripture and stand on it. So I chose Proverbs 18:21 that says, "Life and death are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruit." So I took a post-it pad, and I wrote it over and over and over on this post-it pad, and I posted it all over my house, every mirror, whatever cupboard I get into in the kitchen all the time, next to my bed, next to where I study, and I put it It was Christmas time. I stuck one on a Christmas ornament right next to where I sit on the couch. And every time I would see this verse, I would speak it out. Life and death are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruit. And then I began to say, I speak life. I speak life over every cell and organ of my body. I speak life over my mind. I speak life over my heart. I speak life over my spirit. I speak life over my home. I speak life over my husband. I speak life over his body. I speak life over his business. I speak life over our finances. I speak life over my grandkids and my kids. I speak life over their jobs. I speak life over their homes. And whatever would come to my mind, I would speak life. So every time I would come across one of these, I would do this. In whatever situation, whatever was going on, I would just speak life over that situation. Well, what happened for us was we started to not be able to speak deaf anymore. Every time we would start to, about something, we'd go, oh, speak life. And then we'd stop and we'd speak life over the situation. And it got to where if you started to speak something like that, you knew you were speaking deaf. Well, I've had enough deaf in my body going on. I've spent a lot of years trying to get healed. I don't want that anymore. I want life. And what happened is it's totally changed our lives. Totally changed our lives. I went to bed one night and I thought, you know, I used to go to bed and I pray and toast till I fall asleep. So I thought, tonight I'm going to go to bed and I'm going to just focus on healing, which I had done before. What happened here this night had never happened before. Went to bed, closed my eyes, I started focusing on healing. And when I did, the focus went to my belly. And as that happened, something different happened that night. And I instantly knew what it was. And it was rivers of living water flowing out of my belly. And I could feel it flowing out and coming up over me. And I just laid there going, whoa, what is it? I've never felt that before. I've done this before. I've never felt that before. And pretty soon I started laughing. And I just laid there and laughed. And I was like, oh my gosh, you know, what is this? So, you know, in, where am I? John 7:38 says, he who believes in me out of his belly will flow rivers of living water. And Ezekiel 47:9 says, and it shall be that every living thing that moves, wherever the river goes, will live. There will be a very great multitude of fish because the rivers go there. And everything will live wherever the river goes because there's life in the river. So I met with Kris and I told her what happened. And she said, tell me about that. What does that feel like? If I've never felt that, tell me what it feels like. I said, I don't know what to say except for that I just could feel it flowing out of my belly and up over me. And we just kept talking and pretty soon I said, well, you know what it feels like? It feels like when you get a bit of an adrenal rush. That's kind of what it feels like. And she said, that's really interesting because the innermost being is the liver and the adrenals sit on top of the liver. The kidneys. Yeah, sorry. And so I just went, wow, okay. So today I went and I looked it up and my inmost being in the Hebrew is kalaya, literally the kidneys or inmost part, meaning figuratively the seat of emotions. Interesting that when I had that focus, I started laughing. That there, it's the seat of your emotions. The term was used for the innermost being, the soul, the central location of the passions. Our English equivalent might be in my very bones, or in my heart of hearts. The kidneys were viewed as the seat of human joy and grief, as well as the seat of moral character. So this has been the most amazing thing in my life, in our lives. I laugh all the time. I'm happy all the time. Things come up, it's like, yeah, whatever. You know, let's laugh. Let's go, whatever. Okay. We go to bed at night, and that it gets me a lot then, and I'll start laughing. My husband will say, well, when the bed starts shaking, stop shaking, I'll go to sleep. But I feel like the Lord has brought me back as a captive one, back to Zion. And it's like a dream to me. And he's filled my mouth with laughter and my tongue with joyful shouting. And I will say of the Lord, he has done great things for me, and I am glad.
Amen.
I want to read you the psalm one more time, because what Pam is talking about is she got set free. She got set free from a critical part by going after something, a critical mouth that she had tried to control, but unsuccessfully. And part of her freedom was she had a repentant heart. She came out of agreement with wanting to speak those words, and she cried out to the Lord for freedom. And then God gave her a strategic plan of what to do next, which was, stand on my word, and I'll show up, and you're going to see a change. And so she did. She stood on that word in Proverbs that the Lord gave her, and in that place of partnering with God through his Spirit and standing, she didn't just fairy dust get this thing removed. And it's been going on, she said, since early December. And so I want to read this again, and then we're going to just give Pam a chance to sing her song that she wrote. And during that time, I'm going to do an activation. So this is the version that she wrote it in, New American Standard, Psalm 126. It was like a dream come true. When you freed us from our bondage and brought us back to Zion, we laughed and laughed and overflowed with gladness. We were left shouting for joy and singing your praise. All the nations saw it, and they joined in, saying, the Lord's done great miracles for them. Yes, he did mighty miracles, and we are overjoyed. Now, Lord, do it again. Restore us to our former glory. May streams of your refreshing flow over us until our dry hearts are drenched again. Those who sow their tears as seeds will reap a harvest with joyful shouts of glee. They may weep as they go out carrying their seed to sow, but they will return with joyful laughter and shouting with gladness as they bring back armloads of blessing and a harvest. This is a prophetic answer to Jeremiah's prophecy, and then Daniel prayed into it. There's an angelic proclamation. The Spirit of the Lord stirred Cyrus, and there was a return and a setting free of the remnant. And deliverance came. It came by hearing and seeing a prophetic word. And you just heard a prophetic testimony. It came by honoring that word, praying into it, decreeing into it, responding and going to work, going to work, going to work, going to work over it in the partnership with God, resolved and contending for the word regardless of the circumstance. So we're right now in a valley of decision, and there are things that God is calling you to get free of. that he wants to see you in that same place of joy. And as you partner and honor and contend and believe with God's word, we believe that you're going to get some freedom.
Stay the same. It's time to contend for
for what Jesus has already contended for. And when we get the determination that our God has done this and we're going to partner with Him in whatever it takes, again, it's not striving. It's a release and a falling back into His arms, but saying, Lord, you're going to give me a strategy and I'm going to walk in this thing. And I'm going to stand on a verse. I'm going to make decrees. And I'm going to hit the ground until it begins to get breakthrough. I'm not going to say it once and say, oh, that didn't work. There is a resilience He's building in us to get that freedom with Him. And those things in the spirit that are entanglements and strongholds will not come down without looking at them, partnering with God, and saying, as for me and my house, we are serving the Lord. And you, spirit behind this thing, will not tell me what I'm going to be doing. For I follow the Lord. I belong to Him. And by the word of your mouth confessing and standing on a living word that God gives you, be it through prophetic utterance that you've got, but definitely through His written word, you begin to speak that out. And so just, I believe God's been showing you all some things. We're going to look at this activation, and as Pam begins to continue to play, we're going to use the verse that she used for freedom, the Proverbs 18, 21. And I want you to say this with me as a declaration. Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruit. Let's say that again. Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruit. Let's say it again. Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruit.